Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us tonight. Tonight we have LGBTQ plus rights, how far we've come and where we can go. Our host this evening is Julian Camera. Julian is the field organizer at the ACLU of Colorado. He works with the campaigns department, and Julian was our administrative assistant for a year or so, and then he worked his way up to organizer, and we are so happy to have him in this role. He has a degree in communications and anthropology from the University of Colorado at Denver, and Julian is going to present this lovely webinar and tell us tonight how we can make rights for LGBTQ plus people more of a reality. So I'm gonna send it over to Julian. Take it away, Julian.
Cool. Thank you for the introduction, Delana. Thank you all for being with us tonight to talk about some really important issues. I'm really excited about this, and I think we're going to walk away from this feeling motivated to do more for our communities. So first, I'm gonna go over our overview and goals. So first, we're gonna talk about the history of LGBTQ plus laws in Colorado. We're gonna give you an update on current protections for LGBTQ plus people. We're gonna introduce the Equality Act, which is mostly what's bringing us together tonight. And then we're gonna have a community discussion. And then finally, provide you with some tools on how to take action. I meant to introduce a few folks we have here tonight. We have myself, we have Denise Myers, who is our public policy director at the ACLU of Colorado. We have Brandon Schaefer, who's the political and organizing manager at One Colorado. And then we have Hayden DePorter, who's a good friend of mine and former volunteer at the ACLU of Colorado. Then One Colorado stole them as an intern, and they are currently a DU law student. So then we have another good friend of mine, Deshir Moore, former client of ACLU of Colorado. And we also have Brianna Nichols, who is a good friend of my friend, is an essential worker right now, and has a great voice for speaking about the importance of community and some of the things that we need as a community. So the goals for the webinar is to give you, hopefully all of us will walk away with a deeper understanding of the people and movements that brought us to where we are, continue conversations about LGBTQ plus experiences, and walk away with the tools to mobilize and demand action. So we're gonna jump right into the history of LGBTQ plus rights in Colorado. We're gonna go all the way back to before the 1860s. I do want to mention that as I go through this history, you'll notice that there are groups of people, specifically trans women of color, that seem to be left out of the history, which was unfortunate. But not surprising to discover as I was going through this history. And so just be aware of that as I talk about this. And I think that what happened was, as people fought for gay and lesbian rights, trans people kind of got put into that category. And that might be why we're in the place that we are today, where trans rights are, you know, at the forefront of civil rights issues. So Indigenous tribes in Colorado were known to acknowledge and highly value a third gender, which is referred to in English as two-spirit. Those who identify as other than just male or female could have been a mixture of multiple gender identities and sexualities. And two-spirit acknowledges the continuum of gender identity and expression and avoids labeling someone as being one or the other. This photo here is a picture of a two-spirit Navajo couple from the 1860s. And then, you know, as we know, Indigenous people in Colorado were greatly displaced by white people during the 1859 gold rush, meaning that so were those who were two-spirit. Pretty quickly upon arrival was an 1860 law that made sodomy illegal. This included any forms of anal or oral sex. The punishment was anywhere from 1 year to life in prison. In 1886, laws were created that prohibited people from dressing in clothing that did not align with the gender they were assigned at birth. At the time, many people were dressing in clothing opposite of their assigned gender. And we know this from arrest records, many, many arrest records. And we also know that a sheriff in Denver was on record saying he wanted to run people like this out of town. LGBTQ plus people at the time were mostly underground due to laws that prohibited them from legally expressing themselves in ways that aligned with their identities. Charlie Frenchie Vasbeau is one of the first recorded transgender people in Colorado. He moved to Trinidad from France in the late 1800s. It is unknown whether or not he was out as a trans man or if it was discovered after his death, but either way, people in Trinidad knew and referred to him as a man and as Charlie Frenchie Vasbeau. In 1939, the first underground gay bar opened in Denver called The Pit. At the same time, the 1869 sodomy law was revised to expressly cover anal sex and fellatio, and the maximum penalty was reduced to 14 years. The law was revised to primarily target gay men, which was a trend during this time period where homosexual people, including trans people, were beginning to become a defined and growing community in Denver. In 1953, a psychopathic offender law was created, which put homosexuals in the same category as rapists and child molesters. In 1954, the 1886 laws around how people were to dress in public were revised to make it only illegal for men to dress in feminine clothing. Men, I quote, is because these people were likely trans women or non-binary. And at the time, the federal government also began to remove LGBTQ plus people from the federal workplace. So the 1960s were defined by the civil rights movement. And on June 28th, of course, 1969, Stonewall standoff between police and LGBTQ plus people took place in New York City, which sparked a movement nationwide. Colorado specifically, we saw little to no movement until 1971, when sodomy was decriminalized while at the same time banning public displays of affection between same-sex couples. This led to the formation of the Gay Coalition of Denver, which was the first known like organized group created in Denver. In 1973, Denver police organized a sting operation by enticing homosexuals with a bus at the Capitol. Over 214 people were arrested for entering the bus to engage in sexual activity. As a result, on October 23rd, 1973, the Gay Coalition of Denver, along with many others, went to the Denver City Council, filed a lawsuit claiming that laws targeting LGBTQ plus people were discriminatory. 36 people got up and spoke about who they were as people and how the laws unfairly impacted their lives. Years earlier, Colorado had elected its first Black city councilman, Elvin Caldwell, who was a huge ally to the LGBTQ plus community. As a result of this hearing, four anti-gay laws were repealed. Lewd act, loitering for sexual deviant purposes, renting a room for sexual deviant purposes, and an anti-drag law, which didn't show up here. In 1975, Clela Roex, I might be saying that wrong, issued the first marriage license to a gay couple in the U.S. She was in Boulder, and she also issued many more after. And the same year, the first Pride March took place in Denver after Jerry Jarosz created Unity, which is now known as the Center on Colfax. For this Pride March, 200 people showed up and they were denied the right to march because they didn't have a permit. So instead they walked on the sidewalks. Nothing was gonna stop them that year. The following year, they showed up with more than 500 people and marched from Cheeseman Park to the Capitol and back, which is what we know now as Denver's Pride March. In 1977, it was a time when police were targeting prostitutes, specifically trans women. Police murdered Eugene Levi and Irene DeSoto. Levi's murder contributed to the formation of a group called June 7th Committee. They called for the creation of a civilian oversight board, an end to police entrapment, and a removal of anti-homosexuals from the police and judicial system. That'd be really great. Following Irene DeSoto's death, her friend Monique DeMarco helped form the Transsexual Lesbian Gay Defense Coalition. They presented Denver City Council with a petition requesting a citizen review board over police. They also organized a protest against police harassment. Monique, along with a person named Minnie, showed up as their true selves during this protest, which was known to be very dangerous at the time. Today, Denver has a citizens oversight board and the commission's law enforcement committee, which is known to partner with the LGBTQ plus committee. In 1883, Denver's LGBTQ plus community mobilized to elect its first Latinx mayor, Federico Pena, who was a fierce ally to the community. The 80s was also when the AIDS epidemic hit and discrimination against gay men increased. At one point, the CDPHE was required to collect names of people who had tested positive, and anyone could access this list. So because of that, gay men were denied jobs, they were denied medical treatment, they were dropped from health insurance. It was a very brutal time for that community. And in 1984, Colorado added a legal provision to require sex reassignment surgery in order to change your gender on your birth certificate. That will come up again later in this webinar. In 1992, as a result of a well-funded anti-LGBTQ plus campaign, Colorado voted to pass Amendment 2, which would prevent any recognition of homosexuals as a protected class. In other words, they would be denied equal rights. So this passed by 53%. Colorado immediately became known as the hate state. So famous people like Madonna refused to perform here. People refused to vacation here. We were that state. Denver's mayor at the time, Wellington Webb, came out and said he did not support this amendment and he would not enforce it. And other mayors followed. At the same time, the community brought on Jean Dabowski, who would later become the first woman to become a Colorado Supreme Court Justice. Jean and her team filed a lawsuit, Romer v. Evans, which was appealed all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, who ruled 6-3 that the amendment was unconstitutional and violated the 14th Amendment, which guarantees all citizens equal protection of the laws. This was one of the first positive LGBTQ plus Supreme Court rulings. In 2008, Governor Ritter signed into law additions to the Colorado Anti-Discrimination Act to include sexual orientation and gender identity. Brandon's going to talk about that in a moment here. In 2012, Charlie Craig and Dave Mullins entered Masterpiece Cake Shop in Lakewood and requested a wedding cake for their upcoming wedding. The owner, Jack Phillips, denied their request and used his religion as an excuse not to bake the cake. Craig and Mullins filed a complaint with the CCRC, and it was ruled in Colorado courts that they were discriminating against. And Phillips appealed the case, where it went to the U.S. Supreme Court, who ruled that the CCRC treated Phillips unfairly based on his religion. The issue was essentially went unanswered, and so has left a lot of questions in the air. So I'm going to pass it on to Brandon now, who's going to talk about where we currently are with our rights.
Hello, thank you for having me, Julian. This is really bright spot and really fun, funner thing to kind of cover while we all work from home. So thank you for having me to talk about this. So just want to say thank you again. I'm with One Colorado here in the state, which is the state's largest LGBTQ advocacy organization. Really looking at the history of like where we've been when it comes to sexual orientation and gender identity is really interesting and gives us a lot of context for where we are today and where we go. So part of the first part to kind of focus on is CADA, or the Colorado Anti-Discrimination Act, which is here. And it's almost a state version of the Civil Rights Act, basically outlawing discrimination kind of on like three fronts, kind of in employment, anti-discrimination, and housing, and then also looking at public accommodations here in the state. It wasn't until, I believe it was 2008, until sexual orientation was added here in Colorado. And we also have gender identity, which is not currently in statute. And that's a very big undertaking that needs to go through basically all of Colorado law and statutes and update where CADA is mentioned to include gender identity, because currently it only covers sex and does not include gender identity. So that's one of the bridges where we have to cross to make sure that CADA actually protects all of us in the community and ensure that we have actual statute to protect us and protect our rights when it comes to employment, when it comes to housing, and when it comes to public accommodations across the state. So that's where we are with CADA. And so we're really excited to kind of focus some of our energy this year at One Colorado on really looking for possibly like a next legislative session where we can really get into amending CADA to include that. The other one that's really new as of a few years ago is Jude's Law, which is really, really exciting. You know, we have this whole movement happening around marriage equality for years, but also we have a little bit less focus and an eye on protecting our trans community here as well. And what Jude's Law did after we were able to elect over a long period of time and make sure that we had control of state house and the Senate and the governor's office, we were able to make sure that Jude's Law was passed, which basically just removes the surgery requirement and court order requirement, allowing trans and non-binary Coloradans the ability to self-identify on ID documents. So that's a driver's license, a birth certificate, and that's huge. So part of this is just amending their birth certificate when updating their gender, which we were able to pass here in Colorado. And I think before COVID, and we all were working from home, I think 64 Coloradans had received new birth certificates according to CDPHE, the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment, which is really huge. And since the law has been enacted, close to 400 Coloradans have specifically designated and updated their DMV credentials, basically Colorado ID or driver's license, with the X gender marker, which is huge. So before this law, it really was like that binary system of male, female, and those who didn't identify as either of those in the binary weren't able to fully express themselves in that legal, in the legal system. And now we're able to move a little bit more forward towards updating this. And also removed one of the barriers that existed, which is also really cumbersome and put people's health in danger and their lives in danger, was they needed to have a publication requirement saying that, for example, Brandon Schaefer was changing my name to a new name to match my my new identity that felt right for me. And that Jude's Law removed that public requirement as well, which is really, really big. So we were able here in Colorado to make sure that anyone who wanted to self-identify outside of male, female was able to do so on government documents, which is huge. I'm gonna skip over the gay and trans panic defense. That's one bill that was introduced in 2020 here in this current legislature session, but it is, it was voted on today. So it was tabled indefinitely, not because of the content of the bill, but because the legislature is kind of focusing on important or fast, efficient, and easy legislation right now to get through in response to COVID. And that's one of the bills that was actually voted on by the Senate today to be postponed indefinitely. The gay and trans panic defense legislation that we had proposed and that we had proposed was going to, one of the prongs was a protective hearing if a party claimed that someone's perceived gender, their gender identity, expression, or sexual orientation would have allowed them to make it irrelevant in the case. And so we are currently on pause on that one right now. And that's part of this ongoing like legal equality that we're fighting for, post-marriage equality. So that one's on hold. One of the other measures that we think of when we're talking about equality under the law is not just legislation, but also looking at the existing regulatory bodies that already exist and basically doing like rule changes or amendments to the rules that are currently in place. So with the Colorado Civil Rights Commission, which is where, Julian, you had mentioned earlier, the masterpiece cake kind of came out of this commission ruling. Some of this is, we just added a new rule and regulation just very recently in the past couple weeks here at One Colorado. We were able to lobby and get our members across here in Colorado and the nation basically to say and add their name to this new rule, which will add that harassing and subjecting individuals, differential treatment based on gender identity is no longer allowed. And this was really born out of a particular issue here in Colorado where trans educators were not allowed to be out to their students. So we were able to pass a rule change here that didn't require the legislature's approval, but we were able to just go through the Colorado Civil Rights Commission rules and regulations and basically update and go through and fix a little bit of the law here. And that's really cool too. When you think about like what is legal or how do you approach equality, most people think about laws, but there's also like rule changes as well that make a really big difference here. And so we were able to update that this year. The other part, when we think about current like LGBTQ laws, is another clunky agency, the Division of Insurance here in Colorado. And in that, we were able to, a new bulletin was issued that allowed us to, for carriers and consumers and health service providers, to advise them on the prohibitions in Colorado law on discrimination and health coverage based on one sexual orientation and trans status. So we were able to really make sure that we widened the scope at the Division of Insurance of what they could include in health insurance across the state. And so that's a very, also an updated rule change here as well, that like we were able to advance that equality. But as we kind of think through like post-marriage equality, a lot of this like movement has turned into like, well, what's next? And there's actually a whole lot that we have to amend and fix and really take into consideration. And one of those is also a conversion therapy ban. Across the country, there are still, that practice is still allowed, but here post 2018 and in the 2019 legislative session, we were able to also pass the conversion therapy ban. We were able to make sure that was outlawed. We were able to say it's an classified as an unprofessional conduct and could result in like disciplinary action here in the state. And so it's really big as we think through legal equality versus lived equality here in the state, that these are some of the laws that we have on the books here in Colorado and some of the laws that we are currently fighting for right now, whether that's through the legislature, a rule change. And so it really spans across a few different avenues to think about current LGBTQ laws here in the state of Colorado. I'm excited to talk about this a little bit later, and also the Equality Act. I'm excited to dive into as well, because that's a very long journey to get there, but we're almost there. The Senate is in play this year, so that means that we possibly could have the Equality Act at the federal level. But here in Colorado, we're really working to make sure that pieces of the Equality Act are enacted here in Colorado in different ways to protect all Coloradans here, especially LGBTQ Coloradans and their families.
Cool. Awesome. Thank you, Brandon. We're going to pass it on to Denise to talk about the Equality Act. Oh, Denise, you're muted. It happens to us all.
Oh, I know. I just wanted to thank you, Julian. I thought that history was really fascinating and important. And thank you, Brandon, for giving us an overview of what we have here in Colorado. I'm just going to talk briefly about the Equality Act. It is a federal legislation that's actually passed the House a year ago in May of 2019, and now sits at the door of the Senate waiting for introduction. And there's a big question mark about when that will happen, if at all, in the current makeup of the state of the federal Senate. But anyhow, the reason why the Equality Act is important is because under federal law and many state laws, LGBTQ people are not explicitly protected from discrimination. And indeed, polling and studies, et cetera, have shown that nearly two-thirds of LGBTQ individuals have expressed that they have personally suffered some form of discrimination in their personal lives. What you see here on the first slide is essentially what a summary of what the act does. It, number one, which is the second bullet here, is it it expands to explicitly make note that discrimination is prohibited against individuals on the basis of their sexual orientation and gender identity. And it also expands the areas of where discrimination is prohibited. And we can go to the next slide that will show you where it does expand the areas of what constitutes public accommodation. And so by way of example, the Equality Act ensures that retail stores and banks are covered. And so those institutions wouldn't be able to discriminate on someone based on their gender identity or sexual orientation. The bill also allows the Department of Justice to intervene in any actions that have to do with Title VII protection or discrimination protection. And the last bullet here is interesting because you can be, currently it's unclear whether or not discrimination is permitted just based on the perception that you may have a particular sexual orientation or the perception that you may be trans, for example. And so that kind of discrimination would be prohibited, as well as discrimination based on the individuals that fit in that category with whom you might acquaint or associate. So we can go to the last slide. And this is, I think this bullet is probably the most significant, because what this does is it prohibits the use of the Religious Freedom and Restoration Act, RFRA, as we know it, to permit discrimination. There have been a lot of attempts to amend the Equality Act as it passed out of the House to permit this specific exemption. In other words, my discrimination against you based on your sexual orientation or gender identity is permissible because my religion doesn't accept you. And what some of the amendments or exceptions are trying to do. And what this says is, you cannot do that. There's also an interesting point about the bill that really covers all of these bathroom bills that you hear across the country wanting to be passed to make sure that you go to the bathroom that, fits what your birth or what your genitalia provides, as opposed to one with whom you identify with where your gender identity lies. So that's essentially what the act provides. I will simply say that without it, there are certainly a lot of issues and a lot of ways that the LGBTQ community can be discriminated against. And this act is trying to prohibit that on a pretty explicit basis. I will say, and I know, and I hope that in the coming weeks or so, you will hear more about this, but the United States Supreme Court has two cases before it, one based on discrimination based on the gender identity of an individual, and another discrimination case based on the sexual orientation of the individual. The circuits are split. One circuit has said Title VII, which prohibits discrimination based on gender and sex, the argument being that Title VII doesn't include sexual orientation or gender identity. One circuit said, yeah, it does. And the Supreme Court has these two cases before it now, opinion forthcoming at any point, at any time, that will resolve that issue. But certainly the Equality Act fixes all of the issues and makes the matter more explicit. So that's it in a nutshell. Thank you.
Yeah, I did it. See? Told you. So thank you, Denise. Just a bit here, we're going to talk about how we can take action on to help pass the Equality Act. So we're going to jump into the community discussion portion of this call. And Hayden, Deshir, Brianna, if you want to show your videos and then unmute yourself when you're speaking, that'd be great. So we're going to talk with Brianna, Deshir, and Hayden about their experiences, the good, the bad, in their day-to-day lives of being trans and non-binary. I think it's common to put the trans or non-binary experience in a category and assume, you know, just because one person's experience was good, that that means that all trans people's experience was good. That's not the case. So we want to, one, spark conversations, and two, put an emphasis on individual experiences as well as legal versus lived reality, which is something Brandon talked about earlier, which was so real for me to think about. And so I'm going to ask all of you a couple of questions to the group. You'll each have a couple minutes to talk. And if we have time, I'll ask some follow-up questions to each of you individually. We'll also open it up to those listening in to ask questions and try and answer them as best we can. So I'll start off, and we'll start with Dashir to answer, and then we'll go Brianna and then Hayden. So the first question is, what has been your personal experience of being trans or non-binary at work or at school? And this can be positive, negative, both, but we'll start with you, Dashir.
Hey, Julian. First, thanks for having me. Always, you know, I always like to participate with my friends at the ACLU.
Yep, we love having you.
My experiences while being trans working is actually how we all met. I had a negative experience with healthcare. One of the biggest things when I choose jobs and just trying to, you know, live my best life is, am I going to be accommodated at work? And with this situation, I did all the research, and it actually came back that there was a hidden clause that has an exclusion for being trans. So where I was previously getting my testosterone, once I applied to have my surgery, it was approved, but then once I had it 2 days later, they actually revoked it. So that not only included my surgery, that was my testosterone, that was my behavioral health visits, anything related to my transition, which is everything, I no longer had access to. So that right there kind of made me weary of working. So now that when I do pursue a job, those are the things that, you know, I have to look at. And I even had to leave jobs because of that situation.
Yep. That's, unfortunately, that's too real for a lot of folks in the community. You know, I had a friend who I just talked to the other day who lives in Leadville, and, you know, and this is not in relation to insurance, but she is wanting to start hormone replacement therapy and would rather, you know, quit her job, go to a new one, than kind of come out and face the, like, the masculine dominated environment. So Brianna, if you want to go ahead and answer, what has your personal experience been being trans at work?
Sure. To pick up pretty much right from where you were speaking from, my entry into working as a trans woman happened in between jobs, and I kind of made sure it happened that way, so I didn't have to transition at a job. And it was a much easier transition, or much easier for me to start and have no one have, you know, previously known me at all. So that just kind of picks up right where you had left off. I've had several quick things I'll mention here. So I've worked at a lot of different jobs since I transitioned. It's been about 7 years since I permanently changed my presentation. So just go through a quick little bit of a list here. Misgendering happens all the time. For some people, they're going to be pretty passable. It might not happen that much. For others, it might happen frequently. A lot of times it can even have to do with on a day-to-day basis, just based on how you feel and how other people are perceiving you, based on the vibes you're putting out any particular day. Even when it's unintentional, which usually it is, it still hurts, and it can, over time, it can really wear on you if you're dealing with that on a regular basis. And even if you do transition in between jobs, or if you're quote unquote stealth or whatever, you're still usually outed in the hiring process of any job. So you don't really get away with much as far as, you know, if you've had previous jobs with a different name, especially earlier in your transition, that usually will get you a lot of times, even just to be able to have to go back in your work history and pull out some qualifications or some achievements in your work history. You oftentimes would have to go into things you did under your previous gender and previous names potentially. And then there's also can just be some weird questions that happen with, that come along with being hired. You know, I've been asked, what bathroom am I going to use? And how are you going to handle it if you're misgendered at work by coworkers or by guests? And that could impact how your work goes if you advance and things at work. I worked at Target when they made their big public announcement of, this is how we're going to treat trans people with the restrooms and with our fitting rooms. So I got to deal with immediate backlash from that, including guests in the store saying things because at the time I passed better than I do now for a few reasons, but it still not fully. And my worst experience, and that was over the phone, where I was asked a number of super uncomfortable questions, including if I was trans because they said I sounded like I might be, and what restroom I used. And then they then called and complained about their discussion with me because when I asked them eventually if they didn't have any actual questions, so that they could have a nice day, and I hung up on them. And then they called back and complained about that, and the manager was uncomfortable with me hanging up on them. And then you can just generally be othered at work because you have a hard time relating to others. And that's usually not so much on your end, it's usually on the other people's end. They oftentimes don't relate to you, like men at work oftentimes don't relate to you fully. Like in my case, as a trans woman, they don't relate to me in the same way they relate to other cisgender women at work. And vice versa with the same thing, women oftentimes do not relate to you the same. They don't behave quite the same around you as they do around cisgender coworkers. So it just kind of leaves you feeling, very commonly feeling like, I'm different. I'm an other pretty much all the time.
Yeah, and that's unfortunate because I feel like it's all too common where, you know, you get treated terribly by, you know, coworker or boss, and then you speak out against that treatment, and then you get retaliated against and have to suffer the consequences or leave because you're not comfortable where you are and you'd rather just be somewhere where you feel happy, you feel like you belong. So I think that's why one of the reasons it's so important to keep talking about our experiences. And also I did want to mention, like, you know, just because someone is trans or non-binary doesn't mean they want to talk about their experiences. So when folks want to, like, that's great, but don't think that, you know, someone is automatically wants to talk about their experience of being trans. So we'll pass it on to Hayden. Thank you, Brianna.
I'd like to echo as well what Brianna said about, like, misgendering and being othered. So I use they, them pronouns, and I don't think I've gone a day at school or at, like, an internship where I haven't been misgendered. I mean, it'd be, at this point, thousands of times, but I just have the same phrase that I say over and over again that is just, like, a slogan at this point. But I've had pretty overall positive experience minus a few things. So before the pandemic, I drove Lyft, but last summer when I did my legal name change, I was fired without cause, and then had to dig in to their HR people and go through some hoops to learn that it was just their system was not set up for this. So when I changed my name and it wouldn't allow me to upload my new driver's license, that was a for cause firing. They fixed it at the end, and I worked with their, like, development people. So I'm hoping that it doesn't happen to anyone else because it was a hurdle. But then after that, everything was okay. And then just being a student, it's been really great when I medically transitioned during my 1L year of law school, just the support from my peers, and majority of professors have been amazing, but there are still the comments that I get that just, I think it just comes from a lack of knowledge and ignorance. Like, one professor split up groups into male and female, and then I asked where I should go. She laughed at me and she was like, I knew this would, you would say that. So that was pretty hurtful. And then I also had a professor ask me if I can now self-impregnate and if I start producing sperm and eggs, and so if I can have my own babies. So, you know, there's comments like that you get, and, you know, it's just pretty ridiculous, just the lack of knowledge people have, but it's changing slowly, and the majority of people I'd say interact with are not like that, but you know, you just deal with it on the regular.
Jeez. Sorry to hear that, Hayden. Do you mind sharing with us, you said at the beginning, you said you have a something you say back when people ask you what your pronouns are, or they say the wrong pronoun?
Yeah, so I found that when I have peers who use, like, specifically they, them pronouns, some get really hostile and offended and kind of fight back. But just knowing, having a bunch of friends also who use they, them pronouns, I know it wasn't in our grammar and vocabulary to use these pronouns for, you know, some people 20 years, some people 50 years have never had to use that. So it's definitely something that takes time. So what I've said, which has made other people, I think, actually try harder because they feel like they can mess up, so they're willing to try, is I say, it's okay. Like, some, if I get an email saying, I'm so sorry, I like realize I use she pronouns, it's only people only gender me she. Or they'll say, I'm so sorry that I did that. And then I just say, it's okay, I mess up with those pronouns too. I just ask that you try. And from that response, I think it just shows that, you know, I'm a human too, and I'm gonna mess up people's pronouns because I absolutely do. But you know, you just actively try to correct yourself. And with that response, I usually just get from then, like, people actively gendering me correctly.
Yeah, people are much more responsive when you kind of bring yourself down to their level of knowledge. You know, I try to work on that myself, but I'm not always good. I would be like, grammar's a construct. Like, come on. Anyways, thank you, Hayden. We're going to go on to the next question. So you all three have come from different states. So can you talk about what is the difference between LGBTQ plus rights and community in the state that you came from and in Colorado? We'll start with you again this year.
All right. So I moved to Colorado from Atlanta about 3 years ago, and the difference in rights are the reasons that I moved. Major difference is that most health insurances have trans-inclusive policies, as where in Georgia, they do not. As far as being able to change your name, or it was really simple for me to come and change my gender marker. All I had to do was go to my doctor, get that letter, then go to the DMV. In Georgia, you need to have so many years of therapy, a major surgery, all your letters just to change your gender on your ID. That right there, you know, was a bit much, and just seeing how it was so easy in Colorado and then all the laws that were progressive towards that is one of the biggest decisions why I moved to Colorado.
That makes sense. Yeah, I was going to say also, I think Georgia is like, I think there, so Colorado is one of 22 states to have protections for people based on their sexual orientation and gender identity. And Georgia is definitely one of those states that has no protections, which is around like around 20 or 30 states. All right, Brianna.
Sure, I'm from Kansas, and ooh, Kansas is actually interestingly a little bit of a mixed bag on that. Socially, there's a lot less acceptance in Kansas. It's the Midwest. There's people are far more ignorant on all LGBTQ issues. So for a lot of people, the solution is just kind of don't deal with it. Just kind of out of sight, out of mind. If you are LGBTQ, they just don't really want to know. They don't want to hear about it. A lot of how you're going to relate to them is not going to deal or not going to have much to do with that. It's going to have to do with other things like how well they know you, or if you're polite with them and things like that. But just in general, Kansas is conservative, so there's just the overall laws there are not very inclusive. In the city I'm from, I was part of an activist group that called the Flint Hills Human Rights Coalition, and we actually got our city commission to pass a very inclusive. It was basically an NDOT and. An Employment and Housing Non-Discrimination Act, or Non-Discrimination Ordinance for the city. And when I changed my gender stuff for my gender marker on my driver's license, I did the full range. I changed my name, gender marker, changed everything with Social Security, did all of that at once in Kansas. And it was surprisingly was far easier and smoother than a lot of people have, even here in Colorado when they do those things. I don't know for sure, but I attribute it a little bit to Kansas being a little bit more just freedom oriented, because it's a little bit more conservative. They just don't ask a lot of questions. The process for changing your name and stuff is, for any reason, is almost the same as if you just get married. You just have a letter saying from a doctor saying that, yeah, this is why you're doing it. And then you send that with a court document and a few things out to the state, and they send it right back. Even with Sam Brown back as the governor at the time, I had no problems. So that went pretty well. But as far as inclusiveness in workplace and just general awareness and laws being supportive of trans, things are much better here in Colorado. That was not the primary reason I moved out here. I moved out here for outdoor potential, but
yeah,
it's definitely a nice bonus that that it's just a lot better here than in Kansas.
Yeah, that's really interesting to know about Kansas. I did not know that. I thought it was like Georgia, like no protections, hard life. All right, and Hayden.
So I moved from Madison, Wisconsin, which was unbelievably LGBT friendly. I lived in a co-op full of queer and trans people. So I was in a situation, I came out in college in Madison, and then when I was applying to law schools, once I got in and was really narrowing it down, I was deciding where I would go based on what kind of community I thought there would be, especially the legal community. So I was deciding between Denver and ASU, and my only pull to ASU was that back then I thought that rankings were the only important thing. But then when I did some more research, I found out that they're like have horrible LGBT kind of protections, and it's not a good environment, and then decided on DU, and it's unbelievable, especially the Denver legal community and the greater Colorado legal community is nothing but incredible and so supportive, especially the LGBT Bar Association. And I just cannot imagine moving to Arizona or being anywhere else, because I just think Colorado is fantastic.
And you're in Arizona right now, so.
I am in Arizona, yes, right now. I'm not interacting with anyone though, so it's okay.
Yeah. All right, so we have a couple more minutes. I just want to ask a couple things to each of you individually. So Dashir, you're currently going through Dashir just legally changed his name, finally, and just went through the process. Could you talk a little bit about what that process has been like for you and any resources you recommend?
Yeah, I actually use the resources on One Colorado. Just that generator there just made the process completely easy. You just literally type in your name, your birthday, your address, and it populates the form for you.
Are you talking about One Colorado or Colorado Name Change Project?
But that's how I found it, you know.
Oh, through One Colorado? Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, so that Name Change Project, that actually generates that form there. And then you literally just print it out and it lists all the steps. The hardest part about that, or the step that took the most time, was actually just waiting for your FBI fingerprints to come back. Mm-hmm. My situation was a little different because of COVID-19. I think it kind of helped out because I didn't have a hearing. I dropped off my paperwork at the courthouse on a Wednesday, got a call the following Wednesday saying that it was approved by the magistrate, and I just had to pay for my copy of my documents, my decrees. So in that regard, it's like, yeah, I had to go drop things off at the courthouse because, you know, COVID, it took a little longer for that process, but literally I bypassed that hearing. And I think that's what I was most nervous about, just waiting around for that, having to go and tell somebody why my name needs to be my name, you know. So it has been, out of everything else, out of the COVID, that has been a positive experience. But out of my entire transition, that probably was the highlight, because I told myself I would wait to change my name legally until everything else was done. Like, you know, my surgeries, I was confident in that, had my job, and just everything was in a good space, and my name change would be kind of like the icing on the cake to say it was complete.
Well, congrats to you, my friend. I can't wait till we can celebrate together and not just on FaceTime. So
yeah, when they open up outside.
Yeah, and also I agree with you, like the name change process, it can be super degrading. I was fortunate to have a good experience. The judge was super kind. I know Hayden didn't have such a pleasant experience. I think they misgendered you, right, Hayden, afterwards? Yeah, so it could go either way, but it's degrading the way it's set up, and hopefully that changes in the future. Hayden, you are one of the best, like, you're one of the most friendly people I know. You're, like, a great organizer. Can you talk a little bit about how you've organized community, coming from Wisconsin and just coming to Denver, and, like, all of a sudden you have, like, this whole trans group set up. Like, that's how I became close with Hayden, was because they organized a trans meetup. So if you don't mind just talking about that a little bit.
Yeah, sure. So I'm an extremely community-focused person. That's where I find the most happiness and where I just really get my energy from. And so, like I said earlier, I lived in a co-op in Madison with, like, in that, when I, right when I moved out, there was probably 15 people in the house who identified as either queer and or trans. And I was part of all these things in Madison, and I had this amazing community. And then I get to law school, and I was the only trans person in my entire class. There was one other in the entire school. And then I didn't know anyone, and everything just disappeared, and I was so lonely and sad. So then I just kind of started looking around to see if there were any, like, communities to get involved in, but there wasn't too much around. So I just created this meetup group, this trans meetup group that was pretty awesome. I've made some of my best friends from that. Because, you know, when you share a lived experience with someone, you can just easily talk to that person, and the barriers to becoming close are just so much lower. And it's just easier to go through, especially in law school, when so many of my peers had never met a trans person, and they were asking me 1,000 questions a day that were just definitely didn't need to be asked. So it was an amazing outlet. But yeah, and then since then, there's definitely been a lot of other trans groups that have, like, popped up on Facebook and stuff. So, you know, it's just something really important to me, and I'm glad that I'm part of it now here in Colorado.
Yeah, yeah. And that kind of actually moves me into Brianna, who we were speaking the other night and just talked about the importance of community, you know, for folks who live in remote areas. Brianna, if you don't mind talking about what you and I discussed the other night about community and what that means.
Yes. Yeah, community is very important, and it's not just from, not just other, like, community members from, like, LGBTQ community members, it's also allies. And there seems to be a historical trend where with certain things, that the more people of a group that society perceives there to be, the more acceptance there is. And it seems to be that way with LGBTQ, where the more of us that people perceive to be out there, the more likely people are to know a trans person, to know a gay person, to know anyone LGBTQ, to have, you know, friends or family that are in that community. And just, they're far more likely to be accepting, or to have experiences that will cause them to be further accepting. And it's super, super important that way. It's really kind of a numbers game that way, especially since there's so many people who live in areas that cannot be out. And it's really important for those who live in places that they are able and willing to be out, and maybe even able and willing to also do activist things like this and speak about their experiences and try to help out the local, to help the local community learn what's going on and learn to be more accepting. And that just can lead to things like in my hometown in Manhattan, Kansas, like I mentioned earlier, where we got a local ordinance passed, and our whole thing that we did was activism to get a message out there to make it clear why this needed to happen. And we had it voted through unanimously, even with a very conservative council member who we basically convinced there was no way that they could vote against it without being a bigot. We eliminated every single one of their every single one of their arguments that they had, everything they came up with, we had a way to address it, and we had positive reactions to those from the community and from the council, and to the point of where he would have been the only person voting against it, and his only thing would have been, well, I don't like those people. So,
yeah. That's a great point. And I think, like, as we've seen in this discussion, like, and throughout this whole call, like, we have the legal protections in Colorado. We're one of the most progressive states in the country as far as LGBTQ plus rights, but there's still communities that are feeling left out. They're still being discriminated against. There's still so much hate going around, and it really just takes people, like, all these people, like, the power is within us. So now we're going to go on to how to take action. What you can take away from this call. So you might want to take a picture of this screen. These are links that you can use, but Brandon can talk a little bit about the petition. I mean, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
That was my bad.
No, I totally forgot that we had the take action part. So we here at Lakeland, Colorado, we want to make sure during Pride or what that we are making sure that everyone is like signing a petition to support the Equality Act. We're in a really important year where we can elect hopefully a pro-equality United States Senator who will help us get the bill over the line in the next Congress. So hopefully everyone signs the Equality Act to show that we here in Colorado are serious about the legal equality and making sure that we have that federal protection, not just at the state level.
Yeah, thanks, Brandon. And we'll send out an email with the recording of the webinar and also these links. So if you're not able to take a picture, don't worry about it. We're also, ACLU of Colorado, we have an email action to support the Equality Act. So this link will take you to an email that you can send to Cory Gardner. We're putting the pressure on Cory Gardner, our favorite senator. Also, if you want to talk about your experience, whether it's good or bad, please send me an email. This is my email, jcamara@aclu-co.org. We want to hear your voices. And also, you know, understandably, if you don't want to talk about it, that's totally fine. But if you do feel comfortable talking about your experiences, it'd be great. We want to lift those up. We're also going to be doing some phone banks and text banks in the next couple of months, as well as a postcard exchange to work on targeting Cory Gardner to support the Equality Act. If you're interested in signing up to volunteer with that, feel free to email me also to become a part of this campaign. I also want to thank our panelists for being on here and being vulnerable, sharing your stories. Thank you, Denise. Thank you, Brandon. We do have a couple questions that Delana is going to ask right now. If folks want to hang on for a moment, I know we're past time. So if folks want to hang on to hear some questions, feel free to do that. So.
Yeah, this was awesome. What a wonderful webinar. Okay, so the first one's for Brandon. Do you know anything about how the hearings went about the panic defense ban today? You may have touched on this a little bit earlier, but.
Yeah, it was funny. We were in Colorado, we were in the middle of our staff meeting, and the Judiciary Committee was voting on the slate of bills that were assigned to them from the House pre-COVID. And we were voted 3-2 to be tabled indefinitely. So hopefully either this session, fingers crossed, or next session we'll bring the bill back up because it is a broad bipartisan bill that we have support in both the House and the Senate.
Delina, if you don't mind, I'll just add that there was no testimony at the hearing today. There had been an agreement in advance, apparently, among the legislators on the Judiciary Committee that the bill would be postponed indefinitely, which is to say the bill wouldn't advance out of committee. What I found interesting is that the other bills before it, and there were quite a few before it, were unanimous 5-0 to postpone indefinitely. This one was actually 3-2. So it did cause a lot of consternation. In fact, they had to do the roll call a couple of times because there were a couple of senators that took a pass when they first were called up. So if nothing else, it was a hard vote for them to take, and I appreciate that in and of itself.
Yeah, well, COVID is taking so much from everything, and it's just awful. There's a question for you, Denise. Does public accommodation, I believe this goes back to the Equality Act, include restroom use in the places you listed?
Yes, it does have a provision that, it, as I try to say in my presentation, apologize if it wasn't so clear, it sort of gets rid of this, you know, constant movement to have bathroom bills that force you to go into the bathroom that matches your either how you were born, so what you were at birth, or your genitalia. And so this basically permits you to go to the bathroom that you identify with, where your gender identity lies.
Great. And this is, you know, we've talked a lot about misgendering, and I think we all do it and we feel horrible when we do it. What should we try to do as allies to prevent accidental misgendering? So anybody who wants to take this.
I definitely have a little bit on that. One of the biggest things that I find that I find frustrating, and this happens a lot at work, is being unnecessarily gendered, where there's no reason to use a gendered pronoun, yet it's used anyway. And to the point of where it makes it hard to tell sometimes if somebody is trying to make a point and be malicious or not, or if they mm-hmm. just are kind of clueless. And that gets me a lot. That gets me a lot at work. You'll have somebody like try to address me at work because they want some help, and I'll hear someone from like behind me saying "sir," and I have to make a decision whether I'm going to respond to them or not, because then you're also kind of acknowledging their gendering of you, and that's uncomfortable. And it's definitely a bothering subject for a lot of people.
I think also people have varying levels of comfort. Like, some trans people, I think, are totally open to being asked what their pronouns are. Others don't like that. But a few things that I have found to be helpful are, one, putting pronouns in email signatures, because that encourages the normalization of people's pronouns without having to continuously look to the only trans person to like have their pronouns, as well as if there's like meetings or events or anything like that, just whoever is organizing it or starting the event, to introduce themselves, and especially if everyone's introducing themselves with their pronouns, and then that opens it up to everyone else starting to introduce themselves with their pronouns. And then finally, if someone knows someone uses pronouns that people are messing up, that person could like take it on them as an ally to tell the other person who's misgendering them, not putting the burden on the trans person to constantly say, "Oh, I use these pronouns," because it's hard. Like, I personally, especially at externships when it happens, I've never just in the moment said, "Oh yeah, by the way, I don't use those pronouns," because especially with like a power dynamic, it just doesn't feel comfortable. So then later, if someone, you know, could nudge the person and be like, "Oh, by the way, they use these pronouns," and just as like a reminder if they need it. But at least for my pronouns are always in my email. So if I send an email to someone, like, it's just a soft reminder, and then provide some resources on pronouns as well. So just little passive things like that can really go a long way.
And I'll just add, for me, my situation is a little different. I don't disclose that I'm trans. If you just ask me, I'm a Black man. When I do tell people is when I get misgendered. Now, at that point, I believe it becomes malicious. I've realized that I've had more pleasant experience just by living my life as a Black man, because then once I disclose that I'm trans, let's say I make a new friend, and some things you have to not talk about because they won't understand. So once I feel like that friendship has progressed to where I can trust them, that's only when I let them know, hey, you know what I mean? I'm trans, so my situations may be different. Outside of that, I really don't you know, discuss my pronouns, because how I present is how I expect to be addressed. For me, where I have the most issue with being misgendered is from my own family. So from that, I don't go around holidays, vacations. I won't put myself in a situation where I feel uncomfortable. And that's just, you know, my experience.
Thank you. Thank you all for sharing that. And Grace would love to hear more about how your group got the ordinance passed, Brianna. So maybe a little more about that for us.
Yeah, for sure. So the group that I was referring to, like I said, it was the Flint Hills Human Rights Coalition. And we were a group that started in Manhattan, Kansas. And let's see, this would have been mid-2010s, so like maybe 2012, 2013, somewhere in that range or so, the group kind of got started, mostly amongst kind of the initial widespread push to just to bring some trans recognition and some trans rights into the workplace. Although there had been a lot of laws that and ordinances that addressed some portions of the LGBTQ and also addressed some aspects of life, like some of them would address some portions of LGBTQ in relation to housing and in relation to employment. But they might not include other things that are important. And trans was pretty much not included in any of those. And so the group decided that we were going to try to figure out what exactly the status was of the local protection ordinances, like what groups were protected, what language was being used, where you were protected. And then we proceeded to look around at other states and other cities that had protections and had laws that were friendly that we liked, and started to see what we would want to have included in a local ordinance and what other places had included. And we even contacted a few other cities. I don't remember off the top of my head what they were, but Manhattan, Kansas is a college town, and several is where Kansas State is. And several of the places we contacted were also college towns that had some sort of an ordinance like that. And so we contacted them, and several places either, we contacted like activist groups in the community, or in some cases we actually contacted the city directly and said, hey, how did the implementation of these laws go? And what were the problems that happened? Or when we were contacting groups, we were saying, hey, how did it go when you were working with the city? What problems did you have? What seemed to be effective with the city council or with the state or with, you know, whatever local entities you were working with? And what challenges did you have? And so we kind of tailored our approach based on what was successful in other places. And we had an idea of what challenges we might face based on other places and what challenges they faced. So we came at it pretty prepared. We knew what city council members were going to be supportive or not, partially through talking with them, but also through, like, we canvassed the local debates during the election. And I actually went to a series of debates as one of the board members of this group. And I took, it was like 6 or 7 pages of notes, where there's lots of notes on all the different candidates, what their positions seemed to be. And the very kind of first step that we did was we released a voter guide to the city of through our website and through our organization of, hey, here's where, if you're interested in supporting candidates and have, you know, friends or family, or you're interested in being supportive of LGBT inclusive laws, here's how some of these candidates feel about it. And we actually made a little bit of an impact. A few of the people who could have come across as stronger candidates than they did, when it was made fairly clear their views on certain things, they got blown away in the election. And we actually, during the process of talking with some of these candidates and learning some of their views, we even influenced one of the candidates, because we influenced all of them, but we influenced one in particular that was very interesting, because we seemed to flip his view on on how he thought. He initially, our read of him was that he was going to be non-supportive and conservative towards it, and he ended up with a little bit of education and meeting with a couple of people in our group. He actually was a very strong supporter of our cause when it came down to it, and he voted. Like I said earlier, all of the council members voted in support of it, and the one very conservative council member that we knew was going to be conservative and was going to be opposition, as I said, we figured out partially through talking with him as well, what he opposed and why. And then we specifically addressed those with, well, here's why that's not a problem and why this, why the opposite of that is actually the case. And we don't need to be protecting the LGBT community because they're not actually, they don't have an agenda. They're not discriminating on anyone. They're actually the ones who are being targeted, right? We addressed all of his things. And the issues that some of his supporters brought up in meetings with the city council. And as I said earlier, we made it so the only thing that he had left to say if he was to vote in opposition was that it was going to be simply, I'm going to be a bigot and I'm not going to accept these people no matter what. And he wanted to be reelected. He knew that would hurt his chances of being reelected. And because it was pretty clear that was the case. And he also recognized that our points about, hey, none of your supporters' rights are being restricted. All we're doing is making things fair for everyone, and we're making things fair for everyone in a couple extra areas than they were before. And everyone voted for it. It's been overwhelmingly a positive response since then. And nothing, they have not, it's been on the books for years now, and as far as I know there has not even had to have been much action as far as the enforcement side of it, because there was some enforcement put into the law of what to do if people were breaking that ordinance, and there's been very little enforcement because everyone seems to have been very supportive.
Thanks for sharing that, Brianna. I feel like that really highlights the importance of the city council, which I think oftentimes gets unrecognized for its importance.
Yes, and also to tie it back a little bit to what I was saying earlier about the community, part of talking with the city council was we had people coming up in front of the city council and speaking into the microphone, into the record, and this was all on live webcam, because the city council meetings are all broadcast live on a webcam.
Yeah.
And we would have a line of, say, sometimes 8 to 10 people come up at each city council meeting that you were allowed to speak at and say a few words of support. And when it came to the critical meetings, we had people speaking for as long as they could and large numbers of people. And it was not just LGBTQ community members. It was friends and family and allies, as I was talking about earlier, and that support. That, so it ties it to people who aren't just community members.
Yep. That's awesome. Thank you for sharing. Delana, are there any other questions for us?
Well, we did have a question about a person who was involved in an altercation, and Denise is just going to talk really quickly, a little more generally about the intake process at the ACLU if you have something like this.
Yeah, this particular question asks about an individual who may have been discriminated at a local restaurant. And the question basically is, what is a pathway to get the ACLU involved in a particular case where there is the, where discrimination is suspected? And one of the things we do have, I think, a very robust intake process. So this individual could simply go to our website, go to there's a pull down menu on if you have a potential legal case, you fill that out and it gets sent to us, and every intake is processed in one form or another. And I would imagine that if there is something here to investigate, that we would certainly do it. So that's the best way to get involved, or the best way to get the ACLU involved is to go through the intake process.
That's what I did, Denise, and you guys responded really quickly too.
That's
exactly right, and
that's crazy.
Happy and proud to have done it.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
And that's it for the questions. If anyone else has a question, now is the time to type it in the Q&A box. We are over the allotted time for this webinar, but I don't think anyone minds too much because this was one of our best. And we have gotten such great response. I have to tell all the panelists on the little Q&A, a lot of these questions have been how amazing this is and what great information they've gotten. So those aren't really questions, they're more statements, but you all need to know what a great job you did.
Well, we always appreciate accolades.
yes.
And my phone has been blown up about how great the panelists were. So thank you all for being here.
All right, so we can go ahead and give people some time back this evening to enjoy the night. It's beautiful out there. Any closing thoughts?
No, I mean, I'll just reiterate a lot of the, I'm going to mention real quickly, because this is the second time I've seen it come up on the screen, and it is a comment that is absolutely correct. I think Julian emphasized in his comments that the CADA, the Colorado Discrimination Act, does cover gender identity. So I just wanted to clarify that. I've seen it a couple of times come up in the chat box, and I did want to clarify that and apologize, of course, if there was any misstatement in that regard. But the only thing that I would say is I am also very happy with this panel, proud to be on it. Glad we got people to be who they are. And I love a world when that's permitted. So thank you.
Thank you, Denise. Thank you, Dashir, Hayden, Brianna, Delana, Brandon. Y'all are awesome.
Thank you all. And everyone, if we didn't get to your question, we will try and answer it for you later. But thank you all so much for this wonderful webinar. And everybody have a wonderful night. And we will see you next week.
Thank you.